Hey, hello everyone. Welcome to Flux Office Hours. I'm going to try and share my screen. Can someone write in the chat if you can hear me? I have no idea if this works or if you can see me or anything. Great, thank you very much. Let me start screen share. Is that working? Can you see my screen? Well, let's check. Okay. Cool. Okay, so I've prepared some slides. I'm going to talk today about best practices on securing the GitOps pipeline. And afterwards, I'll try to do a demo of managing secrets with Flux and encryption tools. So first of all, hello, I'm Stefan Prodan. I'm a Flux maintainer, and I work for Weaveworks as an open source engineer. And I'm very happy to see you all here and talk with you about Flux. After the presentation, I please ask questions and I'll try my best to answer them and have an engagement with you. Okay, so first of all, what is Flux? Some of you may not heard about this project. Is Flux is a CNCF incubation project. The end goal of Flux is to enable GitOps practices for when you deploy things in production. So Flux is a tool for keeping Kubernetes clusters in sync with source of configuration. What a source of configuration is, it can be a Git repo, it can be a S3 bucket, it can be a Helm repository, and so on. Also, Flux can automate container image updates to your cluster when you, let's say, you want to deploy a new version of your application. So it does a two-way sync. One is it takes your configuration from Git, and that configuration can be through Helm charts, customizations, plain manifests. And on the other side, it can monitor your container registries, and based on some policy that you store in Git, Flux can fully automate the release of new app versions. Who is Flux for? And here I've identified three personas. So first of all, Flux is for platform engineers that want to build continuous delivery pipelines for their dev teams, platform engineers using Go and the Flux SDK can extend Flux to do other things that what the Flux standard installation comes with. A different group of people are cluster operators. The cluster operators are the ones that are provisioning clusters on different clouds or on-prem, and they are responsible for bootstrapping Flux, installing Flux on that cluster and on those clusters, and making Flux talk to Git repositories and other sources. And finally, the third group are app developers, who of course rely on continuous delivery to ship their code into different stages of deployment. I know, a test environment, a staging environment, and finally the production. So when it comes to securing the delivery process, take into account all the best practices for writing controllers and how to build them, how to test them, and so on. A good example here is a Kubernetes controller should never run as root inside the container, for example. Kubernetes controller, when you deploy it, should have a strict role-based access, and service account configured for that controller. So it can only talk to the API for those objects that it needs to act upon. Cluster operators, is their job to secure the cluster API, the Kubernetes API, who can access it and distribute authentication and permissions to app developers. And of course, app developers, their responsibility is huge, from code to how they write their configuration and to how they actually put together the delivery pipeline. So yeah, security is everyone's responsibility. Oh, I forgot to start my timer, so yeah, starting it now. Is Flux a safer solution for continuous delivery? I would say yes. We've seen in the last couple of years that the supply chain attacks are on the rise. There are more and more vulnerabilities out there. And I think this is because we've put everything inside CI system, the CI/CD systems, which are in fact CI servers, which are doing everything from cloning our code, building our code, pushing it to the container registry, so it has all those secrets to push the artifacts there, but also in the traditional CI/CD pipeline, we call out to the cluster and we run, let's say, a kubectl apply from our CI system. So if the CI system gets, the CI/CD system gets compromised, you have access to basically everything. Not only the source code, but you also have access to all the clusters that the CI system has to deploy to. So you can gain access to production clusters and so on, right? So it's a huge, huge security risk to place everything in one system. The GitOps proposal here is to, you know, break CD away from CI. With Flux, you can isolate your continuous delivery tools and pipelines within your production clusters. And that comes with security benefits. For example, your CI servers no longer have to have cluster access. So the cluster credentials, your kubeconfigs, can be removed from your CI secrets. Manual changes to deployments, to everything that's described in Git, are reverted automatically by Flux. So Flux will detect a drift and will reapply whatever has been manually changed, because we want to have consistency on our production systems, right? So if you are an SRE person and it's you have to deal with an incident and you have to go in there and modify things directly on the cluster, then Flux allows you to suspend the reconciliation for a particular time, do whatever you have to do, then port your changes back to Git, and this is how you resume Flux, and Flux will apply all those patches back, in order to, you know, have this consistency across all clusters. Another feature of Flux is that you can tell it to reconcile sources, let's say a public Git repository, under a restricted Kubernetes account. So let's say you want to install some Helm chart made by someone that you there's not in your organization and you have no control over it, but you want to use that Helm chart inside your system. How can you protect yourself or someone, getting access to that Helm chart repo and adding their cluster admins, load balancers, and so on? So it opens up your cluster to the world, and then it can, take control of your cluster. How you can do that with Flux? You can tell Flux, hey, when you install or upgrade this Helm chart or this piece of configuration, it can be plain YAMLs, customized overlay, or whatever is there. You can tell Flux to use a service account, a Kubernetes service account, impersonate that service account, and do all the operations under that account. So you can create a a role binding for a particular account and only give access to whatever that a Helm chart needs. Let's say, deployments, a service, no load balancer access, and so on, right? So you can fine grain the RBAC for these external sources, be it public repos, or even for your dev teams. Maybe you don't want to grant access to your dev teams to create global objects inside Kubernetes. For example, they should not be allowed to create namespaces or register custom resource definitions. You can do that with plain Kubernetes RBAC and a service account. Also, the last thing I want to mention here is that once you move your continuous delivery tools inside your cluster, you no longer have to expose the Kubernetes API endpoint outside the perimeter. So if you are using a SaaS CI or some other CI tooling and you deploy it from there, then you have to open up Kubernetes, maybe you have to create some firewall rules. And once that CI gets compromised or there is a security vulnerability in Kubernetes API itself, you can get exposure. With Flux, Flux is pool-based, even if you can also trigger it through a webhook, but by default it's pool-based. So you don't have to expose the cluster outside at all. Flux will reach out to the outside, will take your cluster definition from your Git repos or wherever they are, and it reconciles the cluster based on that. So you tell Flux what to do by pushing changes to a Git repo. That's it. So if we adopt GitOps, right, and we use Flux in our pipeline, there is what things become critical. Let's say we've eliminated the CI issues. CI can no longer connect to our clusters. What are the things that you have to pay attention when using GitOps with Flux? And you have to understand that in a GitOps world, there is this idea of sources of truth, right? Where is the desired configuration placed and which container images should be deployed on the cluster together with this configuration to make your application work. Right. So there are two sources of truth in the GitOps. So one, of course, are the Git repositories where your source code lives and also your Kubernetes configuration. And the other source of truth are the OCI repositories, where the container images are being stored. So you need to take into account when thinking about securing the whole pipeline, both type of sources. Now, if let's say someone compromises an account, a Git account, or an account that has access to the container registry, there are two types of access that can a bad actor can gain access to, like read access. If it can read your Git repos and your container images, then maybe you will divulge secrets. If you store secrets in your Git repo and they are not encrypted in any way, they are just there, and you let's say rely on the fact that your Git repositories are private and only the right people have access to it. Once a member of your team, their account gets compromised, then if someone can read those repos, they have basically access to your secrets and they can see your API keys or whatever is in there, right? So it's quite high risk. The second thing is write access. What if an account that has write access, push access to Git or push access to the container registry, what if that account gets compromised? That means if, let's say, the bad actor has push access to your Git repo where the cluster config is, then it could completely take over your whole infrastructure. Because there, it, let's say it can create a deployment with some web server that has a reverse shell, deploy that, and you know, in that way, open up everything. It can create service accounts for its own and so on. So it's really critical to, you know, being able to verify that whoever has write access to that Git repo is actually the person that has that access, and is not, that account is not compromised. And we can see how we'll see how we can deal with both risks using Flux. Secrets management. So as a base rule, you shouldn't store Kubernetes secrets in your Git repos. Kubernetes secrets, when you create one, they are not encrypted in any way. The secret values are base64 encoded, not encrypted. So anyone that can read your repo, it can take that Kubernetes secret, decode the base64 strings, and you know, gain access to your API keys or whatever is in there, database passwords and so on. So first best practice, even if your repos are, you know, private, you should always encrypt your secrets. And Flux has a native integration for Mozilla SOPs, which is an open source project made by, of course, Mozilla, that can work with other encryption tools and allows you to encrypt Kubernetes secrets or any kind of Kubernetes object, whatever it is. If it's in YAML format, Mozilla SOPs is able to encrypt that and keep the structure of the Kubernetes object. So with Mozilla SOPs, you can just encrypt the secrets data keys. So you'll see that the names of your keys, but the values will be encrypted. And that helps with, you know, collaborating on cluster configuration. You may want to know what keys are in that particular secret, if you need to add one, rename one, and so on. But the important part is the key value, and that can be encrypted. And SOPs works with OpenPGP, of course, works with cloud KMS solutions, the AWS one, the Azure one, the Google one, and so on. And it also works with a new, fairly new encryption tool called H, which I will be demoing today. Okay, so for Git repositories, the first rule is you should encrypt your secrets there. Then you can configure Flux to decrypt the secrets inside the cluster. Another best practice is to think of secrets as immutable objects. And customize can help a lot here. Customize has a secret generator, and every time you change something inside your secret, it will generate a new Kubernetes secret object. It has a different name. So every time you do a modification, you'll have a different Kubernetes secret, and Customize will also patch your deployments or other objects where you refer to that secret. So when you change it, your Flux will also trigger a rolling update of all the deployments, of all the pods that have that particular secret mounted. Secrets in image repositories, don't do that. Don't store secrets in container images. Doesn't matter if the container image is well protected. Also, it's not related to secrets here, but it's also a good practice in the GitOps world to not use latest tags. Container images should be immutable. So if you have immutable container images, then you can roll back easily, right? you know from which version to which version you are going, and you can roll back that. If you have latest or some other generic tag that you overwrite all the time, it's quite impossible with Flux to do a proper rollback to a previous state. Unless, you know, you pull the image and you don't cache images on your Kubernetes nodes, which is yet again a bad thing to do. Okay, so we from here, the high-risk read access means divulging secrets. We kind of solve that. If secrets are encrypted in your Git repo, even if someone takes over, let's say your GitHub account and can log in into GitHub as you and has access to a repo, it can see the Kubernetes secret object, but you'll not be able to decrypt the object. Why? Because only the cluster itself can decrypt it. That the private key is never stored in your Git repo. So that's how we mitigate this secret, the risk around secrets. Now, the second issue, let's say someone takes over your GitHub account and you are a member of the platform team, you have access to the main Git repo where all your cluster definitions are, custom resources, service accounts, and everything, right? How do you prevent, even if someone finds out your password, maybe it spoofs your mobile phone and it can, take the two-factor authentication code out of there if you don't use, if you use SMS as the way to do authentication and so on. Let's assume that someone can actually take over your GitHub account and log in there. GitHub allows you to sign commits, of course, being Git, and you can also upload your signature, your public signature on GitHub, and it will show you that verified green check under your commits. But that doesn't have much value if someone can log in as you, because they can generate their own OpenPGP key and they can upload the public key to a GitHub account. And when they do the commit to the cluster admin repo, let's say, that green check will be there. Everything is fine. No one will notice anything from your team. It's you, it's your username, and it has the green check, verified. How can Flux protect you against that type of attack? Where after you bootstrap Flux, you can tell Flux, you can give Flux a list of public open PGP keys, and Flux will, every time it does a pull, it looks at the commit, the new commit it has pulled, and it verifies the signature against the all the signatures that are inside your cluster in a secret. So even if someone takes over your account and it can push their assigned commit, their signature will be different from the one that you have told Flux it's an authorized signature, because that one is in the cluster. Flux doesn't go to GitHub and pulls from there your public key. It looks at the cluster in a particular secret and it takes the key from there. So even if your GitHub accounts get compromised, the attacker is smart enough to sign the commits and it also uploads the public key, that commit will never make it on the cluster. Flux will pull it, will check the signature against its database, which is, again, just a Kubernetes secret, and it will reject that modification. It will never apply that modification because it doesn't match the key. And Flux also has notifications built in. There is a component in Flux called Notification Controller that you can configure. So, for example, if someone breaks into your GitHub, does this commit, Flux will then notify you on Slack, on, I don't know, there are a bunch of other notification systems that work with Flux, and will let you know, hey, I've pulled this commit and I cannot verify it. It doesn't match any keys that you've specified that are authorized for this cluster. So you'll get notified instantly, hey, there is a problem. Someone has committed with the wrong key. Let's look into it, and then you'll probably figure out you are being compromised. Okay, so this is how you can use Flux together with commit signing to protect that kind of attack. What about container registries? What if someone steals your, I don't know, Docker Hub credentials, and then they can push their a container image for something that runs in your cluster under cluster admin, right? I know it pushes the CNI, the network plugin, or I don't know, an ingress control or whatever. It changes that image. It could take over the whole cluster if it can, inject code in there in an app that runs at cluster admin. Then it can do everything with it. So it's very important to also protect and verify the authenticity of the container images that you are running on your cluster. And how you can do that? Today, you can do it with an awesome project called Cosign from Sixstar, where after you push an image to your container registry, you also sign that image, that particular tag. Now, what Flux does, Flux will scan the container registry. You'll see, oh, there is a V101 release. And the policy is update this application to the latest stable release. Great. So it will take that tag and it will write it back to Git. And it will bump the image tag from 100 to 101. Then it will apply that manifest on the cluster. Let's assume the new version is made by a bad actor. You can use Kiverno, which is a project also under CNCF. And Kiverno has a nice integration with Cosign, where you can tell Kiverno, hey, every time there is a change to a pod spec and the image string changes, verify that the new image matches the signature also stored in cluster, the same way the OpenPGP keys are stored for Flux. You can store the cosine keys inside the cluster and tell Kiverno to use that to verify the signature of that particular image. And if that image doesn't match the signature, Kiverno, being a validation webhook, will reject that update that Flux is trying to do. So Flux applies the deployment. Kiverno says no good, it will reject it. Then again, Flux will take the error message from Kiverno that says image doesn't match signature, and it will create an alert through the notification controller. It will send you that alert, and you can actually see, hey, Flux is trying to upgrade to this version, but this version is not signed correctly. It's not authorized to run on this cluster. So this is how you can validate source authenticity, no matter if it comes from Git and its configuration, our Kubernetes YAMLs, or it comes from a container registry, from an OCI repository, and is the container images themselves. Also want to talk a little bit of what we are working on Flux next around this topic. So right now, Flux can take manifest definitions from sources like Git repository, Helm repository, if you are using Helm releases, and Helm controller, which is a component of Flux, and S3 buckets, which are very similar to Git repositories. What we are working on next, we want to extend Flux and support OCI repositories as source of truth for cluster configuration. What that means is in the future, you'll be able to bundle Kubernetes manifests as an OCI artifact and push that as a container image to your registries. Then through Flux configuration, you can say, instead of going to Git, go to this container repository and based on assembler policy, get the find the latest version of the cluster manifests, pull them from there and apply that on the cluster, right? And from a security perspective, what we are looking for, what we want to do is after we pull this OCI artifact with the manifest inside, we'll use Sigstore as a library, Cosig as a library inside Flux, the same way we do today with SOPs and others, to verify the authenticity of that artifact. So we are trying to secure the whole pipeline in the same way we did for the Git repos, apply the same technique to OCI, but with tools that work well with OCI, and Sigstore is one of that tool. And that's what we are trying to do next. One thing I want to tell you is that on October 20th, there is an event called GitOps Days, where we'll showcase Flux, how trusted cloud vendors like AWS, Microsoft, VMware, D2Q, us, Weaveworks, how all these companies are using Flux in their products and how they make use of Flux to build all these secure pipelines. So if you want to join, it's a free event, feel free to join. I'm going for the demo, but first let me look at there are any questions. Okay, so question so far, how Flux connects with clusters deployed in other accounts? For example, if Flux is deployed in a central shared account, reaching out to EKS clusters deployed in a different account, which approach is better? Okay, so Flux has, going to stop screen sharing for a second and answer some questions, then I'll get back to the demo. So there are two ways on how you can bootstrap Flux and use it for your whole cluster fleet. One, you can install Flux on each cluster and tell Flux to sync with the same Git repo. So you can have a central Git repository where you define how, let's say, an application moves from staging to production, and both the staging cluster and the production cluster can connect to this repository and they will look at different customized overlays. So you can create a staging overlay and a production overlay, and each cluster will synchronize with that particular version of your configuration. That's one approach, and this is fully supported by the Flux CLI. There is a Flux bootstrap command that does all of that for you, and we are going to see how that works in a bit. Another option is to install Flux on a management cluster, and from there you could configure Flux to connect to other clusters. How you can do that is through creating Kubernetes secrets that embeds a kubeconfig for the target cluster. For example, if you use Kubernetes cluster API, the cluster API controllers, those controllers, when you push a cluster definition to your repo, Flux will apply that on the management cluster. The cluster API controller implementation will create that cluster for you. Then it will automatically provision this kubeconfig secret inside the management cluster. And Flux can detect that, oh, there is a new cluster created let me connect to it and do the deployments that you have configured Flux to do. But this is not particularly tied to cluster API. With the cluster API controllers, you get the creation of this kubeconfig secret automatically. But if you are, I don't know, running on EKS or some other things that, and you're not using cluster API, first of all, you have to make sure that this management cluster can access the Kubernetes APIs of the target clusters, I don't know, through VPC peering and other things. And then you can manually create these kubeconfig secrets, right? And tell Flux, hey, this Helm release Nginx ingress controller has to be installed on these three clusters. And for each cluster, you can have a different configuration stored in the same Git repo. So there is command and control center, right, where you have Flux and the repo, and from there you control your whole fleet. Or, and that makes the this management cluster a single point of failure in your continuous delivery pipeline. So that's one option. And the other option that we've made it very easy with the Flux CLI command and with our Flux Terraform provider is to, after you create a cluster, you deploy Flux there and just tell it which directory to sync, which overlay or which things to get there. So there are pros and cons to each approach. It's up to you to decide if a management cluster fits better or not. The advantage with the management cluster is that, let's say, the tenant that owns a target cluster will not see Flux there. It's invisible. And if that tenant, I don't know, goes beyond Git and tries to edit things, Flux will override it, but to have no idea that who is doing those things, right? Because it's Flux from a different cluster. That those are the two approaches. About compromising Git repositories, if only release master is allowed to pull on master branch, and policy of the reconciliation will be master branch or even tag. This is not a real problem, is it not? So, no. So if someone gains access to your account, your Git SaaS account, be it GitHub, GitLab, you name it, they can force push and rewrite the history, right? They can rewrite the whole history of your production branch and do whatever they want in there. The moment someone has write access to a Git repo, unless you set up commit signing and you tell Flux to verify that those signatures, anyone can take over your account. I don't see how you can add some kind of protection to Git itself if the account is compromised. If your account is compromised, then you are the cluster admin that has write access to the management repo, right, that controls the management cluster. So that person will be able, that bad actor that has impersonated you when it logged into GitHub can take over your whole cluster fleet. It's that easy. And I don't know, in a traditional CI/CD system, it doesn't even have to hack the Git SaaS provider, right? It only needs to get into Jenkins or whatever you use there, or the CI SaaS provider that you're using. I don't know. There were so many vulnerabilities and so many issues with CI providers lately. So yeah, it's quite hard to protect it with if you don't have some kind of verification and all the signature set up. I'm interested in making some code contributions to Flux, but have been finding barriers. What would be a good forum to provide feedback on new contributor experience? So a good forum is to join our CNCF Slack channel. It's Flux, the name of the channel. There is also a channel called Flux Contributors. You may want to join the Flux Contributors channel because it's less noisy. And you can ask any of the contributors what, how can you get started, or what exactly were the barriers. I'm guessing you are trying to run the unit tests for, I don't know, our C bindings, and those failed or something like that. So yeah, that's Slack is the best way. Okay, let me get back to screen sharing. And yeah, I have still time to do a demo. Okay. So I have here my command line. I have a cluster. That should be empty. It is not. It has Flux. Oh, I'm going to uninstall everything here. I should have deleted that before, but I forgot about it. Okay, so let's see now if everything is gone. Terminating, let me look at other things. I did the test of the demo just before and I forgot to delete all this stuff. Sorry. Okay, let's see now if all it's cleared. Okay, so now I have a standard Kubernetes cluster. It's a GKE cluster, and I'm going to bootstrap Flux on it, and I'm going to use the Flux CLI, and here is the command for bootstrapping Flux on a cluster and pairing that cluster with a GitHub repository. So the Flux bootstrap command is able to create repositories for you using your GitHub or GitLab token. And you can also set a bunch of things for your repos if you want to. If, for example, if you create the repo under an organization, you can add things with read-write access. You can set the repo to be private or public. You can give Flux read-write access. So you can write back, for example, container image updates and so on. By default, Flux has no write access to your repo. So we are adding all these things here. And what will happen is that Flux will connect to GitHub and it will create the repo for me. Okay, so the repo was already there. No, the repo was created. So it has created this new repo for me. Now it does a local cloning of the repository. And inside the repository, it writes all the Flux manifests. So what's special about this Flux bootstrap command is that Flux from this moment on will manage itself. So all the Flux components, the deployments, the custom resource definitions, everything around Flux is in the repo. So if you want to change something in the Flux configuration, you'll do it through the through Git, and you'll not use kubectl edit or anything like that. You modify something in your Flux configuration, you push that change, and Flux will upgrade itself, will change itself based on what you've described in Git. So let's see what the command did in my GitHub. Let's look at this repo that we created. So the repo is private, like I told it to, and it had, right, let me make this way bigger. Everybody can see. Okay, so it has created this path inside the repo. And if we look here in the Flux system directory, these are the Flux components. it's a huge file, has all the custom resource definitions, all the controllers and everything that Flux is made of. And here is the configuration of how Flux knows to upgrade itself. So Flux has several custom resources for configuring your GitOps pipelines. One of the most important custom resources are you define sources as in a Git repository. So is this repo defined here, which we call it Flux system. And there is another object, a customization, that applies whatever it's in the repo on the cluster, and Flux applies itself. So if we go now and look at Flux system, we can see here the components that Flux is made of, these four controllers. For this demo, we are going to use only two of them, source controller and customized controller. And you can also add the image automation controllers on top of it if you want to automate the container image scanning and patching to your cluster. Okay, so what I'm going to do next is I'm going to clone this repo locally. I'm going to get into the repo. Right, I have clusters, going into the clusters directory. And here I'm going to make a directory called secrets. And in secrets here, I'm going to store Kubernetes secrets that I want them to be reconciled on my staging cluster. So today I'm going to use Age, which is an encryption tool to encrypt the secrets. And I'm going to use Mozilla SOAPs to encode and embed the encrypted secrets, the encrypted data inside Kubernetes secret YAML. So first of all, first thing, I'm going to generate a private key with age. Age, like SSH, has two binaries. One is called age and one is called age keygen. We are going to use only the keygen here because SOAPs bundles age and has all the encryption in there. So first of all, we are going to generate a private key. And when you do that, age prints the public key here. And what we are going to do is I'm going to write this public key as a file in my repo. And next I'm going to save the public key in an environment variable so I can have it everywhere no matter if I'm changing the directory or not. So why I'm doing this is I want everybody on my team, everybody with write access to the Git repo, to be able to create secrets and encrypt them inside Git. So what they need is this public key, right? If we look at the key, is this one, right? So this is the public key that can be used to encrypt secrets. If we look at the private key, this is the private key which can be used to decrypt secrets. Now, we don't want anyone to be able to decrypt secrets, so we only want the cluster to be able to decrypt secrets. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to create a Kubernetes secret inside Flux system namespace for Flux to use with this private key. Now that I'm doing that, I've done that, I can remove this private key from here because I don't want it in my Git repo. So now I have created the secret on the cluster with the private key, and I have in this directory my public key. Now let's say I want to create a Kubernetes secret. I'm going to use kubectl to generate the YAML, and I'm going to create a generic secret of type basic authentication. Okay, if I'm going to look at this, yeah, it's a Kubernetes secret where the password and username are encoded, base64 encoded there. If I'm going to commit that to my repo, anyone can will know the these secrets, right? So what I want to do next, I'm going to encrypt the secret using salts. And this is the command. I'm telling salts, hey, use this age public key and encrypt this file, basic authentication YAML, only these fields inside the file. So now if we look again at the basic authentication, it looks totally different. It's no longer a Kubernetes secret as we know it. It has a bunch of fields which SOPs adds there, and the password and username are encrypted. So this is safe to commit upstream. Now, what I'm going to do is, before I'm committing that, I want to configure Flux to apply this secret on the cluster and create the basic authentication secret in my default namespace. How I can do that, I can go to staging. And this is the directory where this cluster is being synchronized. So what I can do here, I can generate a Flux customization object. I'm going to look at it, secrets. And this tells Flux, hey, apply this path, apply all the YAMLs in here on the cluster, and use SOPs to decrypt if there are secrets in there. So Flux knows how to identify only the files that are encrypted and use the decryption on those. And this is the secret where the private key is. You may want to backup this private secret, this private key on KMS on other things, but never store this in your Git repos, right? So what I can do now, I can commit both files. And I can wait a minute or two for Flux to pull the changes, or I can tell Flux to reconcile the customization. Okay, now Flux will pull the latest commit on demand. This is how you can trigger Flux also through webhooks. And now if I'm going to look at the Flux customization, I should see a new one, the one that applies secrets. Here it is. And now if I'm going to look inside the default namespace at the basic authentication secret, I can see that, okay, Flux has created this secret with these values inside my cluster. And yeah, here it is. This is how you can keep secrets safe inside your cluster, allow your team members to encrypt new secrets, add new secrets, and not allow anyone to read them if they gain access to your cluster. And there are more things I wanted to show, but I don't think I'm running probably out of time. Let me see. Okay, I think I went over the 45 minutes. I believe there is no UI for Flux. We are working on a web user interface. There is a web UI project inside the Flux organization now. It's under development. It will take some time until we have something for you to use. Until then, our UI is the CLI. The CLI offers commands to generate YAML, commands to troubleshoot Flux, to debug Flux, and so on. So that's our UI, Git and our CLI. Okay, I'm not sure it's, one second. Don't know if I can keep showing things or not. Okay, I think I'm running out of time. I've talked for 48 minutes. I think that's it. If you have more questions for me, please join CNCF Slack channel under Flux, and we can continue the chat there. Thank you very much for attending Flux Office Hours. Have a great KubeCon. Bye-bye, everyone.